Breathing gently, people enjoy their slumber. But between one breath and the next, there is no guarantee that death will not slip in. To wake up in good health is an event which truly deserves to be considered miraculous, yet we take it completely for granted. Hey yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to the Old Culture Podcast. I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show. Thanks for the time, thanks for the attention, and thanks for all the fish. Hopefully some of you get that reference. Although the context that that line was originally delivered in was more of a goodbye than a hello. But I am not going anywhere, as far as I know. I guess one can never be too sure, can they? And that is a fitting sentiment for our conversation today with our guest, Nikki Weird. Some of you know Nikki, I'm sure. She's one of the more well-known magical practitioners in the game today. Or at least I think she is. For those who don't know Nikki, we'll get into her background briefly at the beginning of the chat. And this one was inspired by a lecture Nikki gave at the Occulture Conference in Berlin, Germany last fall on age-old magic and ways to approach death. It was an appropriate theme there because of the time of the year, and I still think it's appropriate here in the Northern Hemisphere because we're right in the middle of winter, which, if you deal with such seasons, you get it. And it's also appropriate considering recent space weather. That astrology's been crazy recently, especially with that lunar eclipse. A lot of things changing, a lot of things evolving, a lot of things ending, a lot of things dying. Such is the cycle of life, am I right? Hey, Nikki doesn't do a lot of podcasts these days either, from what I've seen anyway, so for her to make some time for us was much appreciated, and hopefully the content and context of the chat resonates with some of you out there. Nikki Weird is in the house, to get a bit weird, right after this.
The time has come to unshackle the beast that you have feared for so long. Relinquish your fear and submit to the cause. You will find all you need in these audio recordings. The year is 1990. Welcome to Occulture.
Nikki, Weird, welcome to the show. Really appreciate your time. Looking forward to chatting with you.
Hello, Ryan. Lovely to hear from you.
Absolutely, yeah. So, you know, Nikki, for those who are unaware of you and your work, give us a nice intro into who you are and I guess the extent of your artistic and magical background. You're a pretty diverse persona from what I've gathered.
Yes, that's true. I wear many hats, often some of them at the same time. So I'm a chaos magician, which suits that particularly eclectic kind of mix of things. I've been a member of the Illuminates of Thanateros since I was 21, which is now nearly 30 years ago. So for a very long time, I've done group chaos magic with people, which I've thoroughly enjoyed. And within that, I've studied various traditions, so rune type of things and Hindu mythology and also different techniques of modern stuff. And I'm also involved very heavily in a lot of the psychedelic uses of ritual and magic, and then also psychedelic science.
You know, the first time I saw your name anywhere was on the Book of Baphomet, and it's not something that I have any questions prepared to talk about you with, you know, just in terms of that book, but do tell people a little bit about that book, because I think, I don't know, maybe in terms of the old culture here, that's probably, I think, what you and your partner Julian Vane are probably the most well-known for. That was a pretty sort of seminal book in this space.
Yes, so the Book of Baphomet was an absolute joy to write. It was also quite a tricky thing, but it was based on the idea that as an ecologist, my degree was in ecology, and I was very interested in the way that humans fit into the rest of the environment, and then coupling that with the occult perspective seemed like a really obvious thing to do. And Baphomet is, for myself and Julian and for other people as well, is the spirit of all life on Earth at this particular moment. So as each organism arises and is born into existence, and then as different other organisms die and fall away, Baphomet, as the collective spirit of all of those creatures, plants, bacteria, fungi, is constantly renewed at every moment. So that's the basic premise that we based the Book of Baphomet on. And then we wrote it together. Literally, we would write it in an email. So I would write some, send it to him. He would write some, send it back. And so it was very much a joint effort where we edited each other's words as well. The funny thing is that after a while, we realized that we were writing stuff and we weren't sure which of us had originally written it. So someone else crept in there.
Yeah, maybe the spirit of Baphomet itself, for sure. I guess I do have a quick follow-up to that. What do you make of the sort of recent treatment of that, let's call it a character maybe, or an archetype on some level? You see here in the States, the Baphomet statue is sort of associated with, you know, Satanism. It appeared in that new Netflix show, that new Sabrina show, had a Baphomet statue in there too. It always sort of is associated, though, with these really sort of dark and like, I guess, satanic, for lack of a better term. What do you make of that sort of representation of it here just recently?
Yeah, it's an interesting thing because Baphomet has got so little backstory that you can pretty much put anything you want to onto that particular figure. The Eliphas Levi version, which is the one that the statue copies, is originally used by Eliphas Levi, but it was subsequently used by somebody who was trying to create a sort of satanic scare. And he popularized this fake news story where he said that people were being holding satanic masses around this figure, and then later on proclaimed at a press conference that it was all fake, at which point the people that had been following all of his news proclaimed that they were all like deeply upset by this. So the origins of the sort of the strange mythologies and the misconceptions around this particular figure date back at well over 100 years now. So the Satanic Temple, as I'm sure most of your listeners are aware, is not actually about worshipping Satan. Their actual thing is about bringing equality of religion to the separation of state and religion within schools in particular. And so they're using this satanic or sort of mildly satanic version of a deity in order to try and claim equality with Christian symbolism in courthouses, schools and such like. And I think on that regard, it's probably quite a sensible, rational move, because this sort of slightly made up deity, or certainly a recently arising deity, is an ideal figurehead for that kind of thing, especially as it does look like with the sort of the goat kind of head. To a lot of people that are ignorant of its background, it would look very satanic indeed.
Absolutely, yeah. And, you know, the reason I asked you here too is because I also wanted to chat a bit about a topic that you lectured on at the Occulture Berlin conference last fall. The lecture was called Age-Old Magic, Ways to Approach Death. And just a quick note up front here too, as we get into the chat, it's probably going to be more of me prompting a transition in the chat than just me asking direct questions, but I'll do my best. And regardless, I couldn't think of a better topic to riff on in the dead of winter than death itself. And, you know, not only is it seasonally appropriate, it's also personally appropriate to me because, I mean, even since 2019 began, or maybe even at the tail end of 2018, my life has seen a lot of death, not literally in like a physical bodily sense, but in the sense of relationships with other people that no longer serve me, and in the sense of aspects of myself that no longer serve me, you know, thoughts, actions, behaviors, and so on. And as hard as this process is, you know, coping with those losses, even if the losses are better for us in the long run, as hard as death is, Nikki, I have come to embrace it, even physical deaths, because I see it now more as more of a healing process than a loss of something or someone, because in a lot of ways, the loss itself allows for renewal, you know, for a new cycle to be born, as you see in nature, and for a new chapter to be written, you know, in our personal relationships with ourselves and with other people as well. And I may have flipped this interview upside down because this seems like a better closing statement than it does an opening one. But, you know, I guess I'm curious if you think of death as a healing process as well. Am I naive or delusional to think of death in this way?
Not at all. No, it's not only a sensible reaction to have, but it's one that has been used by people throughout the ages. So it's like the resolution of a particular movement in music where it comes to the finishing chord. That's how I would think of that final moment. And obviously it's also a time when the suffering ends. Looking at it from a Buddhist perspective, all life is suffering. And then so therefore, when we achieve death and within that paradigm, then that's, you know, the finish of that suffering. But looked at from a more sort of current Western perspective, often the part of life just before there is death, whether it's of a relationship or of an individual, does involve considerable suffering. And so when it comes, then often that's a relief.
Yeah, and you sent me notes about your lecture, and you had a quote from, I think it was Patril Rinpoche, a Buddhist teacher in there. Are you a practicing Buddhist then?
I'm not, but I do know people that are Buddhists. And the meditation practice that I've been doing for the last 30-odd years turns out to have been based on very similar techniques as the sort of Buddhist mindfulness thing, where you are sitting still and you're trying to achieve, well, not trying to achieve because otherwise it doesn't work, but you're hoping to achieve the idea of watching yourself meditate. So you're watching the thoughts arise into your mind and then letting them just disappear again. And when I started to learn this practice, it wasn't called mindfulness or mindful awareness. That particular phraseology hadn't been invented at that point. So I just learned it as meditation, no thought. So I believe it is a Buddhist technique. And so although I'm not a practicing Buddhist, I've been doing Buddhist style meditation for a long time.
Yeah, that's something that I've just sort of recently been dabbling in as well. Gathered some information from resources like yourself and some friends of mine who are into it. And I've only recently began it, but it's pretty powerful so far. I've had a pretty good experience with it. And back to the sort of topic at hand here, I mentioned you sent me some notes about your lecture, and you had a sentence in there too that said this, quote, "Once on this day of the year, all hearths would have been extinguished, cleaned, and rekindled from a new spark to recognize the great wisdom of turning it off, then on again, a technique much used in the natural world as well as by us human folk," end quote. So I was wondering if you could explain that a bit further. You know, the whole turning it off, then on again thing sounds pretty simple.
That was a slightly jokey aside, obviously, but the basic premise underneath it is the same sort of feeling, the same sort of approach that we have when something gets buggy or there's sort of too many programs running at once and we have to turn the computer off and then start it up again. However, when you're taking that analogy to death or to fire or something a bit more sort of real rather than just a program, obviously when you turn it off, it stops completely. And then to reboot it again, you have to get the new material, start all over again and growing it from possibly even from conception. So it's not as simple as the computer version where you just press a switch and then it reboots itself. But the basic underlying idea that mistakes accumulate over time, so sometimes you need to stop and start again, is really, really similar. So the idea that over a lifetime, any organism, not any organism actually, because some organisms don't do this, but most organisms that we are on the same scale as, and certainly ourselves, accumulate different errors and injuries over time. And so at some point, our organism becomes non-viable.
So the question that everyone asks about death is what comes after it and what lies beyond it? And you say that's a question used to control and confuse, because we can never really know, you know, it's only conjecture, and that the better question is, what lies before death? So how would you answer that question of what lies before it?
Oh, that's a very big question with probably a very big answer. So to what I was trying to say by saying that particular phrase to the people in my audience was to try and to get them to think about the bit that happens as literally as we approach death. So that bit before death, not from like from childhood onwards, but from the sorts of point of view of an adult who's getting older and feels that death is something that's, you know, not necessarily imminent, but something that's in sort of the believable future. Like myself, I'm now 50 years old. I'm closer to death than I'm closer to my birth, pretty definitely. So it's something that's approaching. And so it's worth putting time towards thinking about how I spend the last parts of this existence, rather than worrying about what happens subsequently to that, when there's nothing that I can do to change any of those things that happen afterwards from here, because I have so little evidence or reliable testimony to rely on, because obviously anyone that's achieved that state isn't here.
Yeah, it's interesting to think of, like, I think the simple answer is, like, what lies before death? Well, obviously it's life, but what does that even mean? You know, and it, like you said, it's a big answer, because what is this all? Like, what are we doing here? And it's very hard to contextualize it, I guess, in a way that sort of can be all-encompassing, but, you know, it's also, like, maybe it is just that simple. Like, maybe it is just as simple as just being in the moment at all times and just knowing that that will end at some point, but just to enjoy it while it does last. I don't know. Is that too of a simplistic take on it?
Yeah, it's not really deep enough for me, that particular one. I think you have to hold all things at once. So you have to hold that being present in the moment, but also not lose the ability to remember things in the past and plan for the future. And it's holding those three things in a nice sort of balanced triangle, which is, I think, the key to success when it comes to actually surviving this world in a way that has some kind of meaning and pleasure for yourself and for those around you as well. And by those around you, I also include the natural world as well as the people that you know. So I would say that the way that we approach death is something that's particularly good at bringing those three things into sharp focus and into hopefully right alignment with each other, because the knowledge that you are going to die at some point makes you focus on the present very, very successfully. The English writer Dennis Potter said that he was diagnosed with a terminal illness, and while he was dying, he said that it brought the present moment into very sharp focus indeed, and made him celebrate every moment that he still had left alive. But at the same time, you still know that you have got some kind of future just because of the imminence of death. So there are things that you can plan to do during that. And it also makes you sort of, for me, it makes you reach backwards into your past and then also forwards when you're thinking about the legacy and what you're going to leave to people, whether it's the things that you have or whether it's the thoughts that you have or the experience and the knowledge and the accumulated wisdom of the decades that you're going to pass on to people, whether they're your children or other people that you just know, or whether you're going to write things down or however, what way you're going to do those types of things. And for me, the approach of death is making me really be able to stand slightly outside of time so that I can look beyond my own physical tiny dot of a life and see what can happen beyond that, that I can potentially help others to live what I think would be a nicer way. That's my basic premise for what my sort of mission in life is, such as I can.
Yeah, and you also mentioned too that in your notes that or I guess you posed the question, what does the process of growing older mean for people like practicing magicians? You know, what do you learn? How do physical changes affect your inner world? How do social bonds breaking alter your magical practices? You know, and I'm just curious, how do you think about those questions now? You know, like you said, you are at age 50 and a lot closer to death than maybe a lot of us really want to admit when we get to be that age. But how do you look at those questions in terms of how does the process of growing older change, you know, I guess, your magical world inside of you or your practices?
Someone that I know said something really interesting in relation to that recently. And they said that the work of the magician is to sort of perfect the self over time. And so how does one square that particular quest of trying to improve yourself and reach some kind of sort of like ultimate, now I am good at doing things, with the same, at the same time as your body obviously is not doing that sort of stuff. And your body is often, despite your best efforts, throwing arthritis and various other sort of conditions and illnesses at you over time. So that was a really interesting kind of observation that this person had, that the quest of the magician is to achieve perfection, but over time you're less likely to be able to get there. Now, one way of sort of sneakily getting around that, of course, is to change your definition of what it is to be the perfect person and the perfect magician. So instead of being like trying to achieve some kind of ultimate health goal, you're achieving some kind of ultimate being a really good old person who's not that ill type of goal, perhaps. So you're aware that different things are probably going to happen for you. So you take evasive action and you do things which are going to be able to help to alleviate some of the problems that you might have later on in life. So, for example, I know that I have a bad inner ear problem from an injury that I had some years ago. And so sometimes my balance is quite off. It's fine today, but some days it's not very good. And I know that as I get older, that particular thing with me is going to become much, much worse. So in order to help myself with that, I've now started to go to Tai Chi every week, because that's very good for improving your muscle tone, coordination and awareness of your balance. So by doing that, I'm looking at the future and investing this time in myself so that in 10, 20 years from now, when my head is going to be not very good at saying which way is up, the rest of my body will be able to support it and it'll be all right.
Yeah, and I think that's important to keep in mind too, that as you do get older, it is important to be even more active than you were in your youth. I mean, I guess if you can be, because that is really how you maintain good health, both mentally and physically, emotionally, spiritually as well. It's also important to keep in mind too, that those physical health changes that you mentioned, those practices, can also enhance probably your magical practices if you are in fact magically operant. Have you found that as you've gotten older, that, you know, maybe the yoga, the meditation, the Tai Chi, you know, those sorts of practices, have they helped you enhance your magic too?
Absolutely. I think that some of the stories about the sort of the idea of a shamanic illness or a shamanic wound, where the person is somehow like very, very ill, and then they have to learn how to recover from that. And that knowledge of that recovery is part of the magical skill set and the part of the magical fuel, if you like, that prompts the person to be able to do things. I can certainly recognize that in several examples with myself. So the reason that I'm doing the Tai Chi rather than just doing exercise is because it does deal with the flows of energy and things like that. So I'm lucky enough to have a teacher who's very sort of pragmatic, but also includes lots of the talking about the flow of the different chi stuff. So like in last week's lesson, he got us to blink our hands at one point when we were doing one of the poses, and then afterwards asked what we'd seen. And I was able to sort of, I was thinking about it. I was like, I saw a blue flash, but I didn't say anything because it sounded stupid. But then afterwards he said that's, you do that because you're sending out a flash of energy to your hand. So maybe I was actually able to see what I was supposed to be seeing. So next time I will speak up about it rather than holding my tongue. But yeah, the question that you were asking was about whether these practices improve your magic. And I think that they do, because doing body work, which I've been doing for about 20 years now, properly. So I was doing yoga for a long time before it became too difficult because of my arthritic knees, which are now a lot better actually. But for a while I was so stiff I couldn't do yoga poses at all. There was too much strain on the muscles and the tendons. But when I started to do it, I found that having the control over one's own body is a really good position to start with when you're doing magic, because if you don't feel that you've got some kind of ability to move yourself, you don't have to be like obviously an athlete or a top-notch gymnast or anything like that, or even totally fit. There are many times in my life when I've been quite housebound, but having the control that you can do over your own limbs and your own breathing is a good place to start from if you're then trying to control part of the universe as a magician.
Yeah. And, you know, I'm curious too, like, I guess since we're talking about magical practices and then death, is like, where do we see these things intersect? Can you use magic to deal with death on some level?
Yes. I think that when you're thinking of death and also ways to handle it, ways to deal with it, there are things you can do to sort of look into the future, but there are also concrete rituals that you can do in the moment with either objects that might have belonged to a loved one that's passed or photographs that you can use. And so there are ways that you can sort of build in different sort of storylines to the present and the future from the past that then allow you to see the death as just part of the process, where the sun dips down again below the horizon, having gone above it for the person's life. So it's dipping down below the horizon, but that doesn't mean that that day did not happen and is not accessible to you in your memory and the traces that that person has left behind in your life, whether they're material or emotional or whatever. So magic, especially the making of ritual, which I wouldn't presume to tell anyone what to do, because each person is completely different and each person's situation is completely individual and different. But there are ways that you can use rituals to allow yourself to see yourself as part of life's rich tapestry, rather than it all stopping. You can see it as just part of the ebb and flow of things. Ritually going through, watching through a whole night, ritually watching tides coming in and out, that can be a really good process for thinking of death and thinking of the analogy of a life as being one of the sort of the waves of the tide coming in and then going out again. There are many different things that you can do. And the thing that you mentioned earlier on, that I mentioned in my, the thing I talked about in my presentation at Occulture, where I was saying about the fire is kindled from every Celtic New Year. So the way that that would work was that each village would have its own fires and each hearth would be tended by the people. But then on this particular night, all of the fires would be left to go out and left to extinguish and not fed. And then the ashes would be carefully cleaned away, the fireplaces totally cleaned out, and they would have been reset with fresh kindling and a fresh log. And then from one particular hearth, which still did have a fire going, all of the other fires from the village would be relit from this one central fire. And it was a good way of cleaning out your fireplace, which is practical. But symbolically, it was a way of showing that each person could depend on each other, that the village was entwined and enmeshed at a very basic physical and spiritual level with all of the other households within that village, and that if your fire goes out, you can go to somewhere else to be relit. So it's about being able to share that fresh spark that sometimes we all need, and to rely on each other in times of darkness.
Yeah, I think that's great advice there, just to remember that even when things get tough, you should have some people around you that help you make it a little easier. So, you know, I am curious too, speaking of other people, it's always tough to lose somebody, whether it is through death, like physical death, or even a separation of sorts in your personal relationships and whatnot. But is there a way that, I guess, magic can help us through that process? You know, are there, I guess, certain techniques or spells that we can use to help us deal with sorrow and loss and grief?
Well, that's a very good question. There are various rituals which you can use, which are not to... You don't want to get rid of your grief or your sorrow necessarily. That's because it's part of the process of saying goodbye and coming to terms with the fact that someone has disappeared from your life now, and that things will never quite be the same again. So I think that one of the ways that magic can help with that is to, if you're practiced at doing magic and practiced at doing spells, then one of the things that you learn from that is to set aside time to do stuff. So you set aside time every day to do your meditation. You set aside time to do a ritual at a particular moon phase or whenever it might be. And one of the most useful lessons I've learned to do with grief and sorrow or even anxiety is when you're feeling overwhelmed and maybe some weeks or some months have passed since the event and you're thinking, this is starting to become too much for me to bear. One of the things that you can do is to set aside time every day and to say, right, for this time, I will spend this time in grief and sorrow and think carefully about this person and give over to my emotions about that. But for the rest of the day, I'm not going to. And setting aside that time, it seems quite an artificial thing to do, but by doing it, you're not saying to your grief that it's not allowed to exist, but that it can exist within a particular frame, and then it can be treasured. And you can understand why the grief is there. It's because you're missing someone who's very important, that was much loved. And so the sorrow and the grief is not a bad thing, but it's bad if it's not helpful for it to take over your life. And so that's a really good way of being able to contain it and ritually inhabit that emotion for a particular amount of time, whether it's half an hour or an hour or whatever you feel is appropriate. And I've given this advice to, or passed on this advice, because it's not me that came up with it. I've passed on this advice to several people that have been in different situations, and they've said that it really, really helps them to deal with strong emotions.
Absolutely, yeah. And, you know, the magical practices that have always spoken to me the most are, I guess, working with your ancestors. And you had a note here, too, that we really need to, I guess, work on our ancestral wounds, our intergenerational wounds. And you said that many cultures have these sorts of wounds, and we need to work to heal those. What's the best way to go about that? You know, I guess, is it just ancestral work by itself, or are there other things that can enhance that process?
This is something that I'm only just starting to become sort of deeply aware and involved in myself. So I can only give very sort of brief answers to those types of things. But the idea of ancestor work is to engage with the people that have gone before you, either your direct biological ancestors or people that cultural ancestors, whether they might be sort of like well-known or just even more local figures or people that have influenced you in the past in some kind of way. But people that have made the world in which you live, that's the sort of qualifying thing in my mind for someone who's an ancestor. And the idea of ancestor work is to find someone who's gone before that you want to get in touch with and to get to know them. So my example is that my grandmother passed when I was 7 years old, and I knew her very well before that time. But when she died, I was so upset by it, I sort of made a decision not to remember her. So she's a bit of a sort of shadowy figure in my mind. But I've got photographs and I have a few memories of her. And she's someone that I'm sort of, you get to know the story of the person as much as them as a living person. So I'm finding out more about what she did when she was younger, where she lived, where she came from, which part of the world she lived in before she moved to where she was when I knew her as an old lady. And just sort of getting to know this person in that kind of way has really made me understand the roots of my family, so where my father is from and why he was like he was. And then by understanding, you can not exactly forgive, because it's not about that, but just by understanding things, it means that you're not so caught up in the causal web that's prompted by the person. So yes, people do things which cause things to happen, but they come from somewhere. So the things that they do have an origin, which is sometimes with other people, sometimes to do with the whole sort of setting that they emerge from, which is to do with the historical and the geographical and all of those other things around them. And I think by understanding those influences on people's actions and their personalities, then we can have a much better acceptance rather than being caught up in the emotional, but why did they do this? We can be much more understanding about the not holding on to those knotted or potentially knotted up patterns of behavior.
Yeah, and I am curious too, like, how do you balance, you know, working with ancestors and trying your best to heal those generational wounds, and also, like, maybe not getting too stuck in the past, you know, like, because I feel like that is an issue on some level. I don't know if these two things are the same thing. Like if working with ancestors a lot means that you're sort of stuck in that, you know, sort of maybe a nostalgic past, I think you've called it. How do you balance the two between doing the work necessary to, I guess, come to terms with the past and help facilitate healing from it, but also not getting too stuck in it?
I guess that's where the sort of the practice of meditation and such things comes into particular use, because that means that you're sort of bringing it back to today. And also when I'm talking about the ancestor thing, it's important to understand those in the light of now. So one of the things I have on my mother's family side is that there's a sort of history going back of angry men, which a lot of families have. And so understanding why those various figures in my past were angry because of different situations and life choices and things that were thrust upon them and illnesses that they had, like malaria, for example. So some of the reasoning behind why this sort of cloud of anger was there, which the females were sort of, the women in my family were sort of trying to deal with to various different levels of success. But by being able to understand, I can understand my own feelings when I have those sort of temper tantrums in the past. When as a child, I used to be very angry. And I can see that it was to do with some of the sort of the epigenetic heritage that you get from that kind of situation, but also the emotional coping strategies that are presented to one at different points in life. And so it's a complex mix of past and present, but the idea that you can affect the present by looking at the past, and then that allows you to carry into the future without those things being sort of dragging onto you, because you're aware that they're not part of you, they're part of things that happened to your background. So you're able to actually sort of dismiss them and say goodbye to them. It's like the famous George Orwell quote about those who do not know the past are condemned to repeat it. So by being aware of the different things in the past, then hopefully you can cultivate better things in yourself. And do you know about epigenetics?
Yeah, I've heard the term. For people who don't know what that is, could you explain that though?
Yeah. So epigenetics is the idea, which is still sort of mostly a hypothesis rather than proved, although there's evidence gathering around it. But the idea is that your DNA, the expression of different DNA, is different genes, is affected by your environment. So things like stress, but not stress as in, oh no, how am I going to pay the electric bill, but stress as in, oh no, there is no food and we have not eaten for 3 months. So really serious kind of stresses, so famine, very serious long-term traumas and things like this can change the way that your body expresses its genes and then how it lives. So the famine example is that if you're subjected to a long period of famine with very, very little food indeed, then your body will change so that any food that you eat, it will store as much of it as possible as fat. And this change is apparent in the children of people that have been in this situation, and even to their grandchildren as well. They are much more predisposed to put on weight, as particularly as fat. And there's evidence to show that this carries through with things like trauma or growing up in environments which are ones of high anxiety levels. So people that are come from very poor backgrounds, like my family, is that you have a very strong likelihood that you're going to suffer from various neuroses, things like this. And knowing this kind of stuff is helpful because it means that you can change it back again. Periods of meditation, if you do them like for years and years and years, that can like reset those epigenetic switches back to this is a sort of a normal level of anxiety. It's a really fascinating area, and I'd advise people to sort of have a look at what the latest research is, because every few months a new thing comes out about it. So it's worth looking at the latest things online.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's a newer term to me. I probably heard about it a year or two ago, and it was in conversation with somebody that they just sort of tossed it out there. And I was like, what does that mean? And then they explained it to me. And I'm also curious too, like, you use this term in the notes that you shared, terror management. What does that mean?
So terror management theory is the idea that people, as in humankind, is terrified of the fact that it's going to die one day, and that we spend an inordinate amount of our time trying to distract ourselves from this fact. And so that therefore most of culture is in fact a reaction to trying to stop being terrified of death. Now, this is an interesting theory, but I'm not entirely sure about it because I'm not terrified of death. And I'm pretty sure that there's a lot of other people out there that aren't terrified of death. So it kind of like it possibly has bearing in as much as for the last 1,000 years or so since Christianity became fairly widespread in certain parts of the globe, which we're currently inhabiting, then I think that terror management theory has a bit more of a sort of a validity there, because the premise of a lot of the Christian church teachings is that death is really horrifying because you might end up in hell. And so I think on that basis that potentially terror management theory has legs to go on there.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, that speaks too to like just, and you might have a better perspective on this than I do, but it seems that like that the reality that you are going to die, that can be sort of a liberating piece of knowledge. Would you agree with that?
Yes. I don't know how it is in the States, but certainly over here, there's a huge movement which is starting to get underway of people who are looking to die well. And there are various organizations with names like the Good Death and things like this. And the idea is that that death is something that we should plan for and embrace as part of what happens to us as living organisms, rather than it being something that happens sort of in secret. So when someone dies, they just vanish completely and go to a mysterious place called the Undertaker, and then you never see or hear of them again, and it's all very hushed up, and that death is something that's not to be spoken of and is something that sort of has to be dealt with by professionals rather than in the home. So over here, there are now death doulas who are like midwives for the dead and the dying. So they will come and they will lay out the body and wash it and look after the sort of the family and do it within the home environment, rather than it being taken away to some, like I say, a sort of clinical undertaker kind of rubbish disposal system. And the way that this is sort of starting to take hold here is really interesting, because it's part of the same sort of thinking that people don't want to prolong their life unnecessarily at the end. So the sort of the classic thing, certainly in recent times in our country, we're lucky enough to have free medical care, unlike your own country, sorry about that. is that towards the end of life, what tends to happen here for the last several decades is that the doctor has a duty to prolong life, because that's what they have to do. But that means that often towards the end of life, someone will be in a really terrible sort of state with no sign of recovery, with various organ failure, often unable to speak or do very much at all, and being on various life support machines for maybe 2-3 weeks is not an uncommon thing to happen. And it's really tragic to see this, rather than because they'll have had a heart attack or some kind of catastrophic event, but then have pulled through at the sort of the last minute. And there are many people of my age and older as well who are looking at the relatives that they've known that have gone through this process, and they're thinking to themselves that they don't particularly like the prospect of this, because it's undignified. There's no point to it at all, because the person is like obviously in a lot of pain for that last time. And it's horrible to watch somebody in that situation because they're suffering with no hope of recovery. So it's not about being able to choose to use euthanasia on yourself, like there's a sort of assisted suicide type thing, which is also something that's another topic. But it's the idea that you're not going to try and prolong life at all costs towards the end of your life. That's a really mature attitude to have towards this, rather than pretending that it's not going to happen. And so people are now writing up death plans, right, so that when they get to that point, there are clear written instructions about at what point they would not like to be kept alive, so that the doctor does not have to be bound by his oath to prolong life at all costs, which is the situation that they find themselves in at present.
So, you know, I want to circle back to something. You posed the question in your lecture, what can we do as bridges between generations? And I'm curious how you would answer that.
Yes, so that was very much brought to my mind by the idea that as a magical community, whether it's paganism or whatever our particular path is that we follow, we often meet together in groups which include people that are much older than ourselves and much younger as well. So the community that builds itself around the practices that we do spans those different generations. And so we can learn from people that are older, pass on things to people that are younger. And that's an ever-changing and ever sort of like fluid relationship between different groups of people. So it occurs to me that the magical community in particular has a lovely bridging effect between those things. And it makes you be able to step outside of your own individual tiny life and see how it's part of a chain, a larger weaving of different strands.
Yeah. So how do you actually, you know, in this lifetime, like how do you ensure that you're actively seeking out and maintaining connections across these generations?
Mostly just by turning up at things would be my particular take on that, as far as one's able to get out and about, is to stay active and go to conferences, go to festivals, go to celebrations, go to whatever the things are that you're interested in doing that revolve around your magical interests. Do that. And also meeting up with people that you might have known for a long period of time, meeting up on a particular celebratory anniversaries, whether they're to do with the Wheel of the Year, fire festivals, or whether they're to do with birthdays or whatever the things might be. And the simple rituals that you have in those sort of traditions can be very powerful when you're meeting up with people, maybe with their younger relations or however the things work out. But the way that a magical ritual, particularly if it's a celebratory one or a community type of rite of passage or a celebrancy kind of situation, so either a birth, marriage or death, the hatch, match and dispatch school of thought. So any of those type of situations, you tend to have cross-generational type of things happening as well. So magic ritual is something that if you're doing a traditional ritual, and I use that term slightly advisedly because a lot of traditional rituals have existed for maybe 20 years. But if you're doing a traditional ritual, you have this knowledge that people have done this before, and many times they will have done it maybe 100 years ago, or some of the core elements of it could have been used even 1,000 or even many thousands of years ago. The idea of people getting together around a fire, meeting, talking, singing, consuming some kind of shared drink sacrament. This is something that would have happened hundreds of thousands of years ago. So those kind of elements of tradition you can join in with, and you can see yourself as just the latest person that stands into the role and takes on the act of taking part in this particular ritual. And you can see that that's going to happen again for people into the future. And so you can understand the way that you're carrying this wonderful gift of life at the particular moment, but you're just part of a long series of people that are doing this and people that will come after you. And being able to really inhabit that wisdom in a physical way is, I think, one of the most precious things that ritual gives to us, because it means that we can physically really know and savor and really understand how the world is much bigger than ourselves, and how our actions now affect the future, and how important it is that we choose to do as much as we can the right thing, so that we live lightly on the earth, that we choose to do things and choose people to make our decisions for us, that we'll also be able to inhabit this same idea of not being just in it for the short-term thinking of maybe a few decades, but thinking of the century-long view about things, and thinking about the planning, making plans and using that wisdom of looking over a large scale of time. I think that would make a huge difference to the decisions that we're able to make about the way that we choose to live our lives and the way that we plan things in the world.
Yeah, and I think that a phrase here that you have in your notes may tie into this. You said that we should feed ourselves with what we intend to see come out of us. What do you mean by that exactly?
So when you're watching things in the media, when you're talking with different people, when you're choosing where to direct your gaze, whether it's just at a screen or in the real world or when you, if you're thinking more metaphorically and spiritually, then what you choose to look at and observe is necessarily what you will then use to build the world out of that you're creating with your words, with your actions, with your magic. So just be careful to think about what you're doing there. And I'm not saying that you have to ignore all bad things, because that would be silly, because you need to be aware of what's going on in the world. But make sure that you also balance that diet with some really nourishing walks in the countryside, with going to your local park, with looking at the sky, with growing a plant in your garden, anything that you're able to do on your balcony, anything that you're able to do to feed your soul and keep it in touch with human scale things. So the interactions that you have with people when you go to the bakery to buy some bread, when you talk to the person behind the counter and you smile at them and just exchange a few words, those kind of human scale things are really important to do, because they are what make you remember that you are a human animal and that you're not some kind of abstracted digital persona that floats around and doesn't have contact with the real physical world.
You had some good points here, you know, about how we can put effort into our future selves. And they're very sort of, you know, obvious things, you know, proper diet, proper nutrition, exercise, proper lifestyle, which I'm not really sure what that means, but I think it's along the lines of what you were saying. You know, you got to be careful what you consume, but also, you know, travel, which you mentioned, continued learning, you know, real sort of genuine connections with people. I mean, these are obvious things that we all know that we would like to have more of in our lives or to improve on in our lives, but it's never bad to just keep reminding us ourselves that we need these things, you know? So I guess too, to adopt habits now so that we can have them later too. So we're sort of used to them. And as we do get older, that we're, you know, sort of prepared on some level for what may lie ahead for us. And, you know, I mentioned earlier too, that the chat about death is a good sort of, it's seasonally appropriate because we are in the middle of winter here. And something that's fascinated me about this time of year is the idea that this is a time when the veil, so to speak, between worlds thins out or drops completely, which I think it would be another sort of ancestral idea that's been passed on through generations. But you say that maybe despite popular opinion that this other world is not the land of the dead, which I think some people may characterize it as, but it's just the land of the other. And what do you mean by that exactly? How would you characterize this land of the other?
Yes, so the other world in that particular context is the idea that when you're looking at the real world, looking at a landscape, and you've got various hills and valleys and rivers and the different things that go on there, and the European, Northern European view of the sort of the fairy realms is that they are like what you can see in front of you, but sort of underneath, but they're not where dead people go. They're just other. So the concept there is that you have the world of the everyday and then you have the world of the strange, but the strange is just like a sort of like a, not quite a mirror, but a shadowy kind of version. But not shadowy in a bad way, but just like a slightly misty. So it's like here, but not. I don't know if that makes much sense at all. It kind of doesn't, because it's slightly illogical anyway. But the way that sometimes we think of the underworld is more similar to the Mediterranean, ancient Mediterranean classical view of the underworld as being the realm of the dead and the shades, which is not quite the same as the Northern European view, which is much more to do with the other world, the underworld being a place where mysterious and strange magical things happen, rather than it being just like a cave where echoes of people prevail.
How do you work with that other world in your magic? Or I guess maybe the better question is, do you have a sort of, I guess, seasonal approach to magic where you're maybe doing different sorts of ritual or working at this time of the year when you know that that veil is thin or gone completely?
Yes, for several years now, we've been working with the seasons of the year. I mean, I have been anyway, because the pagan wheel of the year is something that's quite widely used in a lot of the communities I'm part of. But for some while now, we've been using those eight fire festivals to use as sort of which is about every 6 weeks or so because of how they fall. So the solstices and then the equinoxes and then the quarter days, which fall halfway between those four different things. So you end up with eight per year. And so looking at those eight different times of the year and then seeing the sort of the different flows of magical energy at different points. So we've just come through, while I'm talking to you now, we've just come through the winter solstice in the Northern Hemisphere. And so that's the time of deep magic. So it's the time of bright, sparkly lights. It's the time of magic for its own sake and celebrating what's going on and giving thanks for that. And then the next thing that's coming up in the system that we use, the Wheel of the Year, is that it's going to be, pagans would refer to as Imolc, which is the time of when milk starts to come in for the sheep. And so that's the time when the first signs of new life are starting to come through. And so that's the time of the year where you would cleanse yourself and you look forward to the companionship that people have for each other. And this time of the year is the time when, although the light is returning to this part of the world, because where the British Isles is quite far north, so we're only just starting to notice that the light is returning. And as it returns and the plants start to grow again, that there's a huge lag between the time when the sun starts to appear and then life actually coming back again. And in that period between those two things happening, this is when the food starts to run out from last year. This is going back to sort of a subsistence agriculture existence. The time when the food from last year would have started to run out, but there's no new food arriving yet. And so this time of the year, this springtime of the year, is in fact when the old and the sick, this is when they would die, because this is when they are cold and there's no food for them to be shared. They're not around the community. And so these months, which are called the lean months, are the time of year when death is much more present, which is kind of what you were talking about with the veil being thinner. Although I would probably associate that more with the sort of Halloween time of the year. But it's all of the dark months now when people are much more vulnerable to the hand of death coming a calling. So the next festival is about the sort of the green magic in the chaos magic system, which is about companionship and looking after each other and caring for each other and that kind of making sure that you're supported by different things. And then that's followed up by the Easter, the equinox, which is to do with the sort of return of life and that sort of joy existence stuff. So this is a cycle which goes around the whole year, which is something that I've very much been following for about 6 or 7 years very consciously now, and holding different rituals on those particular dates or as near to it as we can with myself and my partner Julian Bain and also some of our friends and colleagues that we work with at different places.
Could you share a little bit about what you do at this time of year, or I guess what you think might be best for when that veil is dropped or thinned here?
So it changes every time any of these cycles come around, because we're the type of people that like to innovate. So one of the things that we would do at the start of the winter, when the beginning of this sort of process, when the veil is starting to drop around the sort of Samhain, Halloween time of the year, is that we would, which is between the autumn equinox and then the autumn, the winter solstice. So halfway between that is when we celebrate that thing. And so one of the things that we would do is to have candles and burn candles to people that we know have recently passed away, and particularly to raise a toast to people that are cultural heroes that have passed away during the most recent year. And then to maybe hold some kind of celebration that we're still alive to remember these people, that kind of thing. And then also there was a really powerful ritual that I was part of, which was really lovely. And it was with a group of very good friends, maybe about 20 of us. And someone else did this ritual. And it was about to remember, for each of us to remember each other as we are at this particular moment. So we were dancing around and really looking at each other and being really conscious of the living presence of this other person. And we would say to each other, I see you as you are now. I will remember you like this. And that was a really lovely thing to do, because it was all very much about the joy of being alive at that particular moment.
Speaking of ritual, I mean, we are very near a lunar eclipse here in the States. By the time this comes out, it will have passed, but do you have anything planned for that?
I don't do on this occasion because it's scheduled to happen at something like 5 o'clock in the morning in our time. So, and it's probably going to be very cloudy. So I haven't got anything particular planned for that particular event.
But yeah, it's supposed to happen around midnight here. So yeah, that would be, I mean, if I'm awake, maybe, but if I'm not, then I guess I just won't worry about it this time.
I usually try and mark things like eclipses and so forth with some kind of small ritual, but I haven't got one planned for this one, partly because I'm quite busy preparing for traveling at the moment. So.
Ah, okay. Well, hey, you got to travel to keep that soul healthy, right? So, you know, I think too, let's talk a little bit about tarot just for a moment. You mentioned the Seven of Cups in your lecture too. It seems like a pretty apropos card to draw this time of year. What can we learn from the Seven of Cups?
So the Seven of Cups is one of my, I wouldn't like to say I've got a favorite tarot cards because that's not very nice to the rest of them, but it's a very fascinating one. The concept behind it is something that is really important for a lot of people to grasp. So the idea is that Seven of Cups, here are seven different cups, and from each of the cups emerges a different thing. In the classical imagery of the tarot, there are things like dragons and towers and different figures coming out of them. And the thinking behind this particular card is that here are the different options that you have, and they're options which are like options of emotional choice, because it's the cups. So it's like you can choose between these different things. And sometimes we spend so long trying to weigh up the, which one is it that would be the best one? Should I go for the cottage or the adventure over here? Or shall I just consolidate things and keep still? And we spend so much time wondering about which of those things to choose. They're all floating in a sort of cloud in the air. But until we actually touch one of those things and choose it, none of them will become concrete. So the thinking behind the card is that you have to choose one, at which point the other six options disappear. But then you have actually got one that you follow through and is a real choice rather than them all just being dreams.
Yeah. In your note to me, you know, you said that the Seven of Cups, the note with that was life presents us with an abundance of possibilities, but we can only hold so many things at once. And by choosing to act, the other options fade away, some forever. And that would be a death right there. And yeah. Just, and you also said as one grows older, one knows who one is, and the dreams fall away, leaving what is genuinely achievable in this lifespan. And I think that is a very important thing to keep in mind too, as we do get older, is that a lot of the sort of dreams we had in our youth, it could be the folly of youth too, to dream big. But then as you get older, you realize that, you know, a lot of those big dreams maybe were not even that achievable, but that there are some smaller dreams that you've had along the way as well that are, and it's probably best to focus on those because those are probably the ones that are more impactful.
Indeed, yes, yeah. I've got a friend who's about 17 years older than me, and she once said to me, she said, this is when I was about 20-something, and she said to me, she said, I think I've realised that I'm never going to be an astronaut. And a slightly sort of jokey version of saying that kind of thing. But the idea is that when you get to your sort of, when you're about 28 and you have your Saturn return, which is an astrological event that happens in everyone's life about 28, you have this sort of like jolt which hits you, which is like, this is the things that are actually achievable for you right now. And where are you actually really going with your life rather than going, oh, I can do this, I can do this, which, as you say, is part of the important folly of youth, is to have these dreams and to see what kind of amazing stuff you can conjecture. But then there does come a point where you go, oh, actually, I'm not ever going to be able to do that, am I? And there is a certain amount of sort of grieving that goes along with that sort of loss of that dream. But at the same time, if you're able to then, again, balance that up with the idea that, oh, yeah, but that means that that's because I am doing this. And sometimes you're not even aware what it is that you're doing until after it's happened. There are a lot of the things that I'm doing currently, I had no plans whatsoever to do. They're just things that I've found myself doing. And I'm very happy that I am now doing them rather than my dream that I had when I was younger, which was much more sort of nebulous, and the universe constantly holds surprises in store for us, is something that I'm realizing as I progress through this lifespan.
Yeah. And the surprises come in all different shapes and sizes, and some of the things you dreamt about may come as well, but they may have a different sort of appearance to them. You know, they may look different than you imagined it, but ultimately You know, it's still a beautiful experience when you can manifest those sorts of desires in your day-to-day life. And I think that's a good sort of a segue to my last question for you. And it's a very general question that you posed in your lecture. What kind of old person have you chosen to become, Nikki?
I've chosen to become an old person who's got lots of laughter lines around her eyes, who's got... I want to be an old person who's still able to move around and do things. I will be very disappointed if by the age of like 70 or 80, I'm not still able to, even if it with the aid of a stick, I would still like to be able to climb hills and walk around as much as I can do. And so I would see myself as being someone who's still quite intelligent, still quite liked by people, and can hopefully manage to string a coherent sentence together, possibly even better than I'm doing at the moment.
I think you've strung pretty coherent sentences along this whole time, so I really do appreciate you taking the time here to chat with me. And before we go, tell people where they can keep up with you and your work if they're interested.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure, Ryan. So the blog of baphomet.com, which is where I sometimes post things and where Julian also has his work and another friend of ours, Steve. And over the next few months, you can mostly find me in my guise as part of the Breaking Convention conference, which is happening in London in August. I'm one of the directors of the charity that holds this conference, which is a conference on psychedelic consciousness and the research to do with that. So anyone over in London, come and see us. If not, then check out our videos on Breaking Convention YouTube channel.
Nikki Weird, this has been a weird chat in the best way possible. So I really do appreciate you hanging out for as long as you did. And I guess best of luck in that pursuit of your future self here.
Yes, thank you very much indeed. Great pleasure to speak with you, Ryan.
And there you have it. My thanks again to Nikki Weird. I've always enjoyed her perspective on her craft, and when I saw she was giving a lecture about magic and death, I knew I had to try to replicate that in some way here. And you know, that question I posed at the beginning of the chat about death as healing comes from recent personal experiences where I've had to let go of relationships with people I've been close to for a long time. It's one of those things where every time I interacted with the situations, I felt like a past version of myself, someone I don't want to be anymore. I felt helpless and inadequate. I felt tremendous anxiety and maybe even depression. And I've had enough of feeling that way. And it's strange because these weren't thoughts I was having. These were feelings in my body that I was experiencing. Those of you who've ever had an anxiety attack or a panic attack, it felt a lot like that. And honestly, it took me a while to identify why I was feeling that way, and it took even longer to work up the courage to leave these situations behind. But ultimately, the death of that phase of my life is only going to free up the energy in my body and mind and spirit, and will allow for further growth and maturation of my character and personality, and I'll be able to ground and center myself in, you know, love and compassion, both for myself and for others. Which is the path I've tried so hard to cultivate for myself the last couple years, with varying success. Obviously not as much success as I would like, but any progress is indeed progress. And who knows, maybe the death of these relationships sheds new light on what they actually are or could be, and maybe that presents new opportunities down the road. Of course, these relationships may never cross my path again, and when you make decisions like this, you have to be okay with both of those possibilities, and I am. And I hope by sharing this that those of you listening who may be also experiencing something similar or who have been trying to process something similar, I hope this gives you a bit more strength to act on it for your own benefit. I know this isn't some slick commentary on death rituals or magical rituals, but you know me well enough by now to know that I do my best to take the lessons from these conversations and apply them to the day-to-day experience of just being a human on Earth, here and now. I try, too, to not get caught up in the nostalgia of these ideas either, because I've come to learn just in my own life that nostalgia, yeah, it's powerful, but it's also pretty fucking limiting. It creates illusions and delusions. You get stuck in it and you can't move forward, and that's where I think a conversation like this, which I guess technically was rooted in nostalgia, but that's where I think a conversation like this about death can be relevant to us now. It's time to put those illusions and delusions to rest. Time to move forward, and death is the ultimate catalyst. Anyway, no Patreon extension this time due to time constraints on my end. I had to cut this a bit shorter than I would have liked due to some personal issues that I needed to attend to, so my apologies to the patrons out there for this one. Regardless, a shout out to new patrons Ed, Andrew, Richard, Jordan, Dawn, and John, and a huge thank you to Michael, who became the newest executive producer of the show. Of course, if you're interested in helping keep this show on the air, or in your ear holes, I guess, patreon.com/oldculture is the best way to do that, although there are some folks who have grown disenchanted with Patreon for various reasons, most of them political, I guess, and I get that. You can always donate through PayPal or various forms of cryptocurrency if you're into that sort of thing. You can find all those links at oldculturepodcast.com/donate. Anyway, it's time to put another episode to rest. But we shall resurrect this again sometime soon. Until then, though, you've just been initiated into oldculture. I am Ryan Peverly reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority.
This cassette.